aber urdivial.
What's going on, family? Appreciate you tapping back in with me. Justin Robertson from But Would Ya? You shoulda, you coulda, but would ya? And today, per usual, I got one of my main men in the building. We're gonna go over some macro talks. He's prepared a little presentation that we're gonna touch on as well as we go through it. So sit back, relax, get your notepad ready if you need to, and take some notes. So without further ado, shout out to my main man, Winston. What's going on, my brother?
I'm cooling, man. Thank you for having me on again. I really appreciate we can get together and do these type of talks. You know, I like talking about the macro stuff, and we can dig in to the crypto and tie it all together. So, yeah, man, thank you for having me on again.
You already know. So now that we got all that political correctness out of the way, man, these markets that are testing everybody out here,
Man, that test ain't even the word. I had to get everything off of my phone, like any wallet off my phone. I had to just get it off so I wouldn't look at my portfolio and put it on my ledger. Just get it out of my face, you know, because it's rough when it gets like this.
Yeah, man, it really is. Like, I use Zapper 5. Shout out to Zapper. If you want to sponsor the boy, hit me up. You know what I'm saying? I use Zapper 5 all the time, and I haven't, I guess I shouldn't have said that after saying this, but I haven't opened my Zapper in a minute, right? Because it's like your full portfolio breakdown, they link it to everything, all the different DeFi projects, all your NFTs, and I'm like, ooh, down bad. So definitely been keeping that on the back burner. But yeah, so we're going to get into some of these macro talks. So let me go ahead and throw on my macro talk with Winston Buckley, my main man. Let me back up, make sure they can see. Oh, okay, we're good. Fresh shave. So we're going to go over some of these macro talks and kind of like what you said, getting things off the phone. I guess we can kind of roll right into that. There's been a lot of news recently in regards to centralized exchanges and them pausing or halting withdrawals. So that's a pretty big topic. I think we could definitely touch on. And then there's several others, but I guess the biggest ones that I've seen recently were obviously Celsius, most notably with their CEO getting stopped at the airport and they refused to let him leave the country. Some say that he was trying to flee the country. He said that, you know, he was just going about his business. So who knows, neither here or there. Next up, the next ones that are looking to stop withdrawals are BlockFi. And then obviously we had Three Arrows Capital as well go under. And we spoke briefly about some of these previously, but, you know, it was just a good point that you're saying getting things off your phone. While you're getting things off your phone, you might want to get them off centralized exchanges. And like Winston said, make sure you're putting them on your cold storage device. I personally use a Ledger. I got other videos you can check out on how to set that up. But Winston, have you had any issues with any of these centralized exchanges or anything like that?
Yeah, man. Before I do that, that was really good how you put those plugs in there. So yeah, I see you on your marketing game, brother. I see you. But
family friendly.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, the crazy thing about this is I knew this was going to happen. If you've been through a bull and a bear cycle before in crypto, and you've been through either run on a bank or just high volumes with exchanges, it's like you know what's going to happen, right? And so I'll make a long story kind of short. I had some funds on Celsius. And right now they're in limbo, just like everybody else that, you know, has funds on Celsius, just wondering, okay, what's going to happen? So in the case for Celsius, you know, they have a liquidity issue, and we'll get to talking about that a little later. But even outside of that, when there is high volume, maybe because there's just a lot of action in the market, a lot of exchanges just can't handle the volume. So whether it's a phone app, whether it's a centralized exchange, whether it's DeFi, like a lot of them have problems when there's just a lot of volume on the network. So, you know, like Justin said, man, make sure that you have a ledger and you're only using exchanges for what you're trading. You know, it's so much risk. One is, you know, they can lock up withdrawals at any time for any reason. That could be for regulation. That could be an app crash. That could be insolvency issues. There's counterparty risk. Like, there's so many things with apps, but we need them. We need them to on and off ramp. But yeah, man, I'm waiting to see what's going to happen with Celsius, just like everybody else.
Yeah, man. So it's a super unfortunate event. And, you know, we talk about it all the time, but it's like, it's way different when you see it close up. I mean, as close as it can be, right? When it's happening to you, it's like, oh, wait, what? Like, so best wishes there. Hopefully they can come around. I mean, honestly, there was a lot of talks about JP Morgan, I believe, wanting to buy out Celsius. So, mm-hmm. you know, I thought that was a sign of life, right? If nothing else, right? So best case scenario, as far as a crypto enthusiast goes, okay, JP Morgan, huge financial system, wants to come in and basically get into crypto with the already proven platform that people are using. So I was like, okay, that's a good sign right there. And then on the flip side of that coin, well, maybe they don't want anything to do with crypto, but they are recognizing a distressed asset that still has value. Right. So they're just picking up an asset that's distressed right now, and they expect that asset to gain its value back and then eventually sell it. So either way of both of those opinions, good for crypto. Obviously, I don't work for JP Morgan, so who knew? I don't know what they're really thinking, but so I just figured that was a nice little touch there. Okay, so getting into the markets really quick for everyone. We got Bitcoin sitting right now at about $20,300. I was watching out for the short side this entire time over the weekend, right? I expected some type of small pump and then a little bit of a retrace before we actually get that relief rally. And basically what that would do is called a bull trap for the people that don't know. So during a bull trap, right, you get the market to FOMO, fear of missing out, FOMO back into the market. They think it's going to keep going up and up and up. And as people FOMO in, that's when, you know, they switch the lever and it starts going back down again before everyone jumps ship, right? They lose a little bit of money, they get back out before ultimately reverses again and it starts going back up. So I thought a bull trap would play out, and it does seem like that is kind of the scenario that's happening. As we got up to about $21,800 and now we're back around $20,300. Did you want to go ahead and pull up some of the info that we're going to be going over?
Sure, man. I have some slides that I put together. It's part of a show that I'm working on, and I'm thinking about titling it Greed, like the money episode, and just talking about like how we got here. But I thought I'd introduce some of those slides today. That's all right with you?
More than fine. Yeah, so whenever you're ready, you can pop them on. I'll remind everybody while Winston's getting to that, man, you know, I'm a little humble guy. I don't ask for money or anything like that, but you could pay me by leaving a like, hitting the share, hitting the subscribe. I call it don't forget to pay. So hashtag don't forget to pay. Make my day. I appreciate y'all. But yeah, Winston, go ahead and throw that up. And when you're ready, we can kind of jump into some of those slides.
All right. Can you see what I'm saying?
Yes, sir. Bitcoin USD chart.
All right. So I thought I would start here just to touch on what Justin already just depicted. So Bitcoin right now is sitting around that 20,000 mark. It fell from grace, so to speak, from that top of 69,000. So, you know, what happened? Like, how did we get to this point? Well, if we just back out a little bit, you know, Bitcoin is the king of them all. So where Bitcoin goes, the market goes. And we can see the market cap over time. So from June of last year, you know, the market cap of Bitcoin went up quite a bit, you know, because all the money that went into it and is back down. So that's just another view of what we just talked about. So what in the world happened? Well, this is what happened. The money printer got turned on. And whenever the money printer gets turned on, it flows into the market. So the Federal Reserve participated in all the initiatives. Just start. This is not something recently, but quantitative easing. So basically pumping money into the market. My video isn't planned for whatever. Let me see if I can get this going. Nah, it's not planned. That's all good. But you get the idea. The money printer was turned on. Quantitative easing, putting money into the market. So how exactly do they do that? Well, the Fed has a number of tools. They can raise interest rates, which they're doing now, and is causing, you know, quantitative destruction. But on the flip end, quantitative easing, or QE, which you see at the top of this chart here, you can see from 2008, so, you know, way before this bull market that we're experiencing now, the Fed has been pumping money into the market by buying securities. So basically they're buying assets. They're putting stuff on their balance sheet. And so if they're buying things, let's say if I buy something from you, I'm giving you cash. So if they are buying securities, if they're buying treasuries from the market, they're putting money into the market. So from around 2008 all the way up to 2021, you can see this go from around $1 trillion that they pumped into the market up to over $9 trillion at the end of 2021. And you can see that it's like almost a steady rise from 2009 or so all the way up to 2020. But then the pandemic hit and it just went bananas. You know, it's like double in that time frame, just this short time frame of 2 years. You can see just the amount of QE that was pumped into the market. Now, this is a chart. It's on Shadow Stats. You might want to check that website out. I reference it quite a bit. So they do a lot of alternative graphs as opposed to what's out there on the Bureau of Labor Statistics. A lot of things that the government puts out, they take that information, but then they add some other stats to it. And they call, you know, what they do is like the true analysis of the market. But this is the money supply, and the money supply has different tiers. There's M1 money. I think it goes up to N5, but M1 money is the money that's circulating in checking accounts in the banks. M2 is the M1 plus savings deposits under 100K and money that's in money market mutual funds. And then the M3 money is the M1 plus the M2. So all of those above, plus the large time deposits, institutional money. So the big money, like the big bank funds, big treasury funds. So you can see, is this kind of mimics that previous chart that we looked at. The money flow is, or the money supply, kind of steady, but then bam, 2020, look at this, at M2. So that's the money that's the M1 money, the circulated money, plus the money under 100K. So think about everything that came into the market over the past 2 years, and a lot of that money probably hit your household. So that was $5 trillion from 2020 through 2021, right? And that's $8.3 billion in March of 2020, another $3.4 billion. Then the big one, the first big one, $2.3 trillion in March of 2020, $484 billion. You had the PPP loans in July.
That was trillion, everybody. So make sure.
Right, yeah. So exactly.
$8 billion, $3 billion, $2 trillion. You know, just to put an emphasis on that.
Right. That's not a typo. $2 trillion, right? And over the summer, that's when the fun started for a lot of people. PPP, PPP, EIDL, that's right, EIDL loans, the low wage assistance, student loan interest, housing deferment, you had car deferment. So people would basically had no bills plus extra money. So summer of 2020, everybody was getting lit. And, you know, I'm here in the Atlanta metro area. So, you know, Atlanta opened up pretty much before everybody. I think Georgia, Texas and Florida was just in a race to see who could open up first. And, you know, we opened up before anybody else. Right. So everybody was coming.
Opened
here.
Up. You guys never closed down. What are you talking about? Well,
we cracked the dough for like 3 weeks. You know, we closed the screen though, and we put the latch on the dough so we could still look out. And then, you know, we went back outside.
That was about it. You guys have the door locked with the Cheeto like that, and that meme going on. just barely. But no, that's excellent. And I threw up the M2 money supply and what it means down there at the bottom, guys. So you guys can check that out as we go along. And I pulled up a close up because I had a question about what we're talking about, but it evaded me. So I'm gonna go ahead and get back to rocket. So let's get back to it. So $5 trillion spent. I apologize. Keep continuing.
No, you're good. All right. So a little more in December 2020, $900 billion, and then bam, 2021, another $1.9 trillion. So you had all this, and then there's, I don't even know if this is going to go through, but there was another bill that was proposed, the Build Back Better Act, and that was supposed to be another $4 trillion. So some people are saying, if that $4 trillion came into the market on top of the $5 trillion over the past 2 years, that inflation would just be, it would be like a Hunger Games, Fear of the Walking Dead type situation right now, if that much money went into the market. But we see what $5 trillion did. So just like double that and just think about what that would do to inflation. But that bill.
Imagine.
Go ahead.
Sorry. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead.
No, I'm saying that bill still may go through.
Yeah, I was actually going to say they're trying to kind of rework the Build Back Better bill right now, and they're just trying to make it into a different, different name. I guess you know the way they do bills is they get a main point together, and they propose that main point. It may get reviewed, it may not, and then they get a whole bunch of side points that they've been trying to sneakily get across, and they'll say, "Hey, well, we'll give you that main point, but you got to allow X, Y, and Z," and then that's how little things that make no sense, you know, that have to do with the main bill come to pass. And there's plenty of examples we can point back to. But I did see here that it looks like the Dems are still trying to raise now $2 trillion initiative for a replacement of the Build Back Better. So I thought that was pretty interesting. Although it doesn't look like it's going to get passed. So imagine, everybody, just to do a quick recap of kind of like what Winston was talking about, like how did we get here? How did we get into this economic situation? Well, we've been printing money since 2007. That's when quantitative easing started. So this entire time since 2007 all the way up until now, literally until last month, they've been putting money into the system, right? Printing more money. And then when they're doing that and printing that money, the government would then go and buy bonds. And then that gives liquidity into the system. So you're making the system, aka the markets, more and more liquid so people can trade in and out of them. And when the government's pumping money into the markets, people get a sense of confidence or bravado that they shouldn't necessarily have. And they go, well, I'm really smart. I bought Apple when it was $100 and now it's $170. It's probably about to go to $250. I'm going to keep buying. And you kind of lose sight of what's really going on and you lose sight of the bigger picture because, you know, what do they say? Fat cows get slaughtered or something along those lines, right? So everyone just keeps fattening themselves up as they go because no one wants to think about the bigger picture, the bigger issues that are at hand while everyone's having a good time. But that leads to eventually the music having to get stopped. And when the music stops, it usually stops abruptly, and that causes a lot of turmoil in the markets. So that's just on one side of things. That doesn't take into account everything else, you know, like maybe a world war happening, or take into account the unemployment rate, even though it's pretty stable right now. That's one of the big things that drives the Fed's decisions as they go along. So I just wanted to give that little bit of recap of how we got here. We've been printing money into the system since 2007. It should have stopped in like 2017, 2015, once we got out of the housing recession, but it just didn't. And then they actually are now reversing position. And instead of doing quantitative easing, they're doing quantitative tightening, where they're actually going to be removing, I think it is it 30 billion a month, 50 billion a month, I believe.
I can't remember the exact figure.
I actually have it here. So, at least for June, four treasury securities held by the Fed are maturing in June. So when a security matures, it means that they are able to sell or liquidate that asset. So those four securities in June are totaling $48.2 billion, leaving $18.2 billion over the $30 billion runoff cap to be reinvested. So what this basically is saying is that there is a $30 billion cap for the Fed to be removing money out of the system. And once they remove the $30 billion, anything over, they can reinvest. So it's just something to be aware of. But that is per month. And so that quantitative tightening is going to restrict a lot of things going forward. As Winston was pointing out with the $5 trillion spent already, you know, we're just now, as of this month, stopping that quantitative easing and printing more money into the system. So continue, Winston.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I want to circle back to this Build Back Better, because I want to get your opinion on this after I go through these slides.
Yeah, for sure.
All right. Now, you know, stuff gets real political when it comes to who spends what. But I just threw this chart up here because a lot of people say, well, it's Biden's fault. Some people will say it's Trump's fault, it's Obama's fault, it's Bush. It's everybody's fault. Republicans and Democrats spend money. So this is just a global
thing. It's a bipartisan
thing.
Problem for sure.
Right. You know, and it's just political. So, you know, I don't know if anybody, this is not a political show, but I just wanted to make this point. This is the spending, our debt, just over time. Like, this is the U.S. debt. This is all the borrowing to pay for stuff and kicking the can down the road. So, you know, that was a point where we didn't have trillions of dollars of debt. but all the way back from 81. So, you know, I know some people say that Reagan was the best president ever. Some people say Clinton was the best president ever. But look at our debt ceiling, our U.S. debt, all the way from $1 trillion to about $30 trillion, where we're sitting at now. So everybody spends money. All right, so hopefully that, you know.
I'm in debt. $50 trillion on my $50 trillion on my balance sheet. Yeah, I regret. Oh, man.
I don't even know this is going to play because I think my camera is acting a little funny, but this is, oh, yeah. It's PPP money. So this is what everybody was doing.
Yeah, I think I did read a little bit about that story where, so basically everyone, you know, was getting the PPP loans. And in this particular story, this gentleman had a consulting firm in New York, and he decided to basically say he had 400 plus employees with a monthly salary bill of over $2 million. And he received over $7 million in PPP loans. And he took that and went and bought a mansion. And then he moved to, where did he move to? I forget where he moved to, but he moved out of the country. He moved out of the country, and he just recently got extradited. Okay. Yeah, he just got extradited to come back and face his charges of COVID relief fraud. So,
yeah, so many stories about this. Now, the trip part about the people that are getting busted with the PPP loans are that on one hand, it's unfortunate because it's a lot of individuals who created fake businesses or, you know, kind of scaled their business up on paper to get these PPP loans. So the money flowed both personally and through businesses. But I have these two slides here just to show where some of that money went, right? So this is on the individual side. A lot of it was stimulus checks. So, you know, we all love the stimulus checks. Like that was it was nice getting just checks in the mail, individual checks. But I remember when my first stimulus check came and then the second one came and then they were talking about a third one and then they had some for the children. And I remember calling my mom. I said, Ma, in all your years on this earth, has the government ever just given you money like this? And I was like, something's wrong. You know, she was like, oh, son, this one's coming, that one's coming. I was like, Ma, it's about to get bad. They just sending you direct payments. But
you know what? I got very surprised because I got three checks. And I didn't even file for any of them at first. At first, I don't know. I'm not a big government guy. I'm not a big, you know, I think that it's very important that we have federal funding for programs. But I've never really been the one to go. I never needed the funding, right? So I never, you know, I'm happy that we have it. And I'm happy that it helps people, you know, and gets people to where they need to be. But, like, I personally just haven't needed to really embark into too many. And then, you know, it was going on for so long that I was like, well, I guess maybe I just should file something here. And I ended up getting like three checks. And I was just like, what? Like, because I took so long to do it and I didn't file right away, they all came like back to back to back. And I was just like, wait, all these people got all this money? And I'm sitting here thinking about how many people we have in our nation. I'm like, this, like you were just saying, basically, this can't be right. This can't be life.
It was just too much money coming from too many different directions. So just imagine somebody Just imagine somebody who is able to get all the assistance, right? So you got your stimulus check, plus you're unemployed, right? So you got the SNAP extra. And then let's say you got a student loan. Let's say you went to ITT Tech, right? So your student loan is getting deferred. You got the child care block.
You went to Trump University.
You went to Trump
Right.
Yeah, got the child tax credit. So it's money coming from every which way. You don't have to pay your car off, you don't have to pay your housing, and you got extra money, right? On top of that, go ahead. Good, what you was about to say, Jesse?
I was saying, and interest rates are at zero, you know. So
interest rates are at zero.
Money everywhere.
Cheap money. They just begging you to borrow money. They just please come get this money. Plus, on top of that, you know, Ray told you about the EIDL and the PPP, and he gonna run it up for you, and he know who can get you 100 racks. So then you got the PPP, then you ran up the EIDL.
Hold on. I just gotta say this because I had that, you know, from a small town on the East Coast, things might move a little bit different out there than they do where I'm at now in life, right? I had a friend hit me up. Hey, bro, look. I can get you 10 grand. All you got to do. Cut it off right there. Cut it off right there. Man, look, hey, boop. I'm good, brother. I miss you. I miss you, boop. But you know what? I'm going to catch you on the next one. You know what I mean? So I just wanted to, that would hit home for a second because I received those texts. So.
Oh, man. Yeah, we all got them. We all got those texts. I got those texts, man. Look, I can get you XYZ in 2 weeks. Plus, on top of that, I don't know if this was happening in your neck of the woods, but the blessing circles, man, the blessing circles was coming up. All the SUSU program, like money was just, you know, people was like, okay, you put a grand in and we got this circle and there's 10 other people that's coming in. And then it was talking about, you know, this is your blessing from the Lord. And they was talking about the African, they was using the African SUSUs. And I was just like,
something's it was up.
Like, you know, it's not a pyramid, but, you know, it's just drawn like this. But don't look at the shape of it. But it's not, you know, I got all them kind of.
It's called a triangle, not a pyramid. Why don't you
So. Man. All that, you know, trying to drive the point home, just how much money, you know, when we see these big numbers that's going all these different places, it's like, okay, well, how does that come on? And that's what happened. Now, this is outside of what the big corporations got, like what Delta Airlines got and all the other airlines got, you know, what the state governments got. Like, I mean, we're talking about money in the system. So what happens? Everybody is going to invest, right? So on the retail side, you don't have to pay no bills. We don't know if the world is about to end, but you got this extra money and you've been hearing about investing. People been telling you to invest forever and you got Cash App, Coinbase, and Robinhood and nothing but time. So what you gonna do? All right, let me throw this extra $500 I wasn't even expecting into Bitcoin. You know, I've been hearing about this. I've been wanting some Amazon stock forever. I've been hearing about this GameStop and AMC. Yeah, let me run it up. So that's what happened. That's what happened. And that's just on the retail side. Now, let's look at this chart here, right? So this is the Dow Jones from the 80s through 2022. But let's just look at this time period right here. So from 2017 to about 2020, this crazy dip right here, that's COVID. That's when the pandemic first hit. So the market is going up the entire time, just steadily over 2 years. I mean, all the way from 2007, like right after the Great Recession, just a steady climb up, right? Just a steady climb. But from 2017, so when the first, you know, like, I guess you can call it like major crash happened in Bitcoin, when it went from 20 down to 3, for 2 years, it was pretty much flat. And the market in general is going up, but Bitcoin is pretty much flat. And why is that? Well, we just talked about why it went up all of a sudden in 2020, because all this extra money just got pumped into the market, right? So it's both retail and then venture capital. So you got all these venture capitalists that's flush with cash now. Plus, you know, JP Morgan got some extra money, you know, plus Bank of America got some extra money. Pension funds got extra money, you know. These churches got extra money. My church accepts ETH and USDC. If you want to, you know, I believe in giving an offering and all that. But, you know, even the church was on it. Church is running it up. So if you got everybody running it up, this is what happens, you know. And so shout out to all their podcasts. But I was listening to them a few weeks ago, and they were just saying, forget the prices that you saw in 2021 and 2022, because it was just based on this crazy market. Like, it was just a banana republic.
It was the size of
the
Fugazi. It's fake numbers.
It's all fake numbers. And, you know, it's kind of hard to come to grips with, because like you said earlier, Justin, I felt like a genius. Everybody felt like a genius. You know, especially if you bought something in March of 2020. And, you know, if you bought anything in that month, oh man, you couldn't tell me nothing.
Couldn't tell me nothing. You was like Drake. You knew you was going to the top 10. As soon as you dropped, yep. Top 10.
Back to back. It was back to back, bro. I was on the edge.
Nah, and I was actually I was fortunate enough to catch that all in pod as well. So for anybody listening to this right now that doesn't happen to listen to the All In podcast, it's a really great macroeconomic podcast, and it's a pretty diverse opinion. Like I would say, you know, they give both sides of the spectrum. It's not like an echo chamber where you're just hearing the same thing over and over. So it's really great. And in November, actually, I can quote this because it stuck with me because I didn't take action. No. Anyway, so in November, Chamath Palihapitiya was speaking on the All In podcast, and he said, look, Jeff Bezos is selling all his stock. Elon Musk just sold a bunch of his stock. Chamath said, I am selling my stock. He's like, so if some of the smartest people in the space are selling right now, you know, he's like, I'm not telling anyone what to do, but he's kind of left the writing on the wall there. So, you know, there the opportunity was there, and that kind of points back to what we were talking about, like people just thinking they're extremely intelligent, extremely smart, and I'm sure people are. Like I still consider myself intelligent, you as well. We just, or for me anyway, I got caught up in the moment, and I was just riding so high because I, you know, my portfolio was up over like 2,000%. So you know that's. You feel real good about that. You feel extremely confident. But the thing is that when you get that extreme confidence, right when you're about to take a screenshot and send it to the homies, like, yeah, you see me, I'm out here. That's when you need to take profit, right? Go ahead and take the screenshot, take profit. Because if not, you're going to, you know what I mean? You had a gun, you should have cocked it. Like, you're going to end up losing. So I just wanted to point that out there because, again, All In is a great podcast, and that Chamath quote like stuck with me because he literally said, hey, you know, Elon's selling, Bezos is selling, I'm selling, some of the smartest people you know in the industry are selling. I'm not telling you what to do, but, you know, the writing's kind of on the wall. So just wanted to put that out there.
Man, that's really good. I know that same podcast that you were talking about, and I remember in November because – that was a mistake that I made as well, not taking some profit off the table at that time, because I saw some headlines where a number of companies were paying off their debt and buying stock back. Like they were really hedging for something to come. And I'm like, okay, then I hear that All In podcast about what Chamath was saying. And I was just like, you know, if billionaires, like these are like billionaires multi times over. And, you know, they've been in the space for an extremely long time, but you're right. Like, I mean, who's getting bigger than Elon? And even Buffett, you know, Buffett is very traditional, but he was just holding on to cash while like everything was running up. You know, he's very critical of crypto, and that's where we disagree. But, you know, he's seen all kind of markets come and go. So, you know, he was just sitting on cash and now he's buying, you know? So it's like, if you pay attention to like what the consider smart money does, and then even like the indicators, like we probably should do like the feeler indicators, because whenever there's euphoria in the market, and it's not an indicator to say, okay, what's hype and euphoria, but you know, the echo chambers were all over Twitter, and you know, you saw the Google ads and the YouTube ads, and you know, everybody was just showing you, let me show you how to do XYZ. It's time to start taking profit. And you know, it's crazy because we've seen this and 2017, 2018, like we've seen the same exact thing. But, you know, I think I've been studying this stuff on like social engineering and how you're throwing off your game and how you manipulate it, you know, to believe mm-hmm. that things are going to happen a certain way. And if you get the same messaging over and over for a period of time, you know, you might be being set up for exit liquidity. So it's deep. 100%. I ain't mean to go on that kind of tangent, but you know, a lot of stuff that's out here is, you know, for us to be used as exit liquidity.
Yeah, I mean, like at the end of the day, I heard the good brother Ian Dunlap, the master investor, say it very well. Like when you're getting into investing, you're playing a sport, and when you're investing in these big markets, you're going against, you know, LeBron, you're going against Kobe, you're going against the best players in the world. So if you think that you're just gonna come out here without stretching, having no experience, hitting turnaround, fadeaway, no look, Curry threes, like, then you're going to get caught. You're going to get caught slipping. So Like I ran it on the bottom here, and I'll just read it out loud as well. But like Jeff Bezos sold about $2 billion of Amazon.com stock after pledging that amount this week for restoring nature and transforming food systems. As a part of this Bezos Earth Fund, Bezos sold 608,000 shares. So he sold about $2 billion, and that was on November 3rd. And then on November 13th, Elon Musk sold about $6.9 billion in Tesla stock on November 13th. So it was like. And like I said, that was right in line with the All In podcast. So, you know, some of the signs were out there, and we have to just be held accountable for it. Hold yourself accountable. Like you saw the situation. First of all, you know, pat yourself on the back for getting there, right? Because if you did it once, you most likely can do it again. Now, it might take patience. It might take you recognizing the things that you messed up and recognizing where you need to make adjustments. But you did do it. Like, and you did it. So you can, you know, it is possible. And I believe that's a big thing for at least people that came from my background or come from my type of surroundings where it's like, oh, I can never do that anyway. That's only for rich guys or only for XYZ. It's like, nah, bro, like, you know, you can do it. A little bit of dedication, you know, read a little bit, YouTube, and you can figure it out. So, you know, pat yourself on the back if you did do it. You know, congratulations, you did get there. Now recognize that there are things you're going to have to change, things that you're going to need to be aware of, and, you know, make those hard decisions next time, right? And when you do it again, because you will, as long as you stick with it, when you do it again, you have to recognize those same things. And when you get those feelings, when you're about to take that screenshot, when you hear the billionaire saying they're selling, you know, now that alarm bell hopefully goes off, and you're like, no, you're not getting me again. Let me go ahead and, take a little profit, but would you? You know what I mean? That's excellent.
Yes, indeed.
I knew we went on a little tangent there, so sorry for kind of.
Nah, that was excellent. But you know, hey, even in that, so for some people in crypto, this is their first bear market. You know, some people that are listening here, watching, 2020 might have been the first time they ever invested in crypto, or 2021. And so now they're looking like, man, what in the world did I do? Like, everybody's been lying to me. But you know, there's some people, this is where I started, right here. November 2017. But wait, hold on. I'm going right here. Wherever 2017 is.
Hold on, let me get it on the screen.
November 20. Yeah, so that 2020 drop down to 3,000, that's where I started in crypto. So even let's say if somebody started right there, look. Yeah, I mean you're still okay. Like at worst you're even. You know, if you started in 2017 and you're here now, like you're even. So long-term investing is still where it's at. So all isn't lost. But you know, if you sell and you're down, then you know all is lost. But
exactly, yeah.
You know, all that money that flowed in, it went in different places in crypto. And you know, as much as I try to preach it, sometimes people lump crypto all into one thing, and it's not. So on one side, you got Bitcoin, you know, quote unquote store of value, most secure, the first one, the granddad of them all. And then on the other side, you got meme coins, where you know they're fractions of a penny, and it's all based on culture, like it's all based on hype and belief. So people were just drawing money in both areas, or one side or the other, and they were making money, you know, just taking blind bets, making money. And then you had leverage. You're taking leverage on your gains and taking out a loan, and then taking that loan to get more leverage, and then more leverage to get more loans. And this wasn't just a retail thing. Like these are the crypto funds, the VCs, the hedges, the traditional institutions, like everybody was doing this. Don't this sound kind of familiar?
So I was going to say, so this is where I'm going to like, you know what I mean, kind of pause it for a second, because like, okay, for the people that aren't caught up to date with this, we spoke about it kind of right at the beginning of this conversation. And then I believe Winston and I spoke about it on our last macro talk as well. So go back and listen to that if you haven't heard. But yeah, so this is where the market, this is where we realize that we're all human, no matter if it's retail, institutional. A lot of people laugh at crypto investors like, oh, you guys are silly. You guys are crazy. You know, you're just getting dumped on by the institutions. And I mean, a lot of times that is true. I'm not going to, you know, say it's not. But the responsibility and accountability factor that everyone has to take on in these type of situations. Right. So there's a lot of different ways you can take leverage. For example, I could have a home. I could go to a regular U.S. bank, put my home up as collateral, get equity, put that equity, let's say I get $10,000, whatever, just to make it easy, put that $10,000 now in my bank account. I put that $10,000 on the Coinbase, and now I buy Bitcoin with that $10,000, hoping to go up. Technically, I'm leveraged up because it's not, you know, hard money that I have here. I had to go do a few things to get that money. So that's just one way to lever up. But then you can also use a decentralized platform like Aave, right? So this is one of the ways that I was using leverage. I would take, say I already had $10,000 worth of crypto, Bitcoin, Ethereum, whatever. I put the Ethereum on that platform. They would pay me a small interest rate for me lending them that liquidity. I would get paid a small interest rate, and then I could borrow back 50% of that, right? And I can rinse and repeat, and that's another way to leverage up. And then you have like a more traditional way you would think about leveraging up is where you just go onto an exchange and you're trading, like Binance or Bybit, and you say, hey, I wanna buy at this price, and I'm gonna do 3, 4, or 5 times leverage, meaning that if it goes up 1% and I have 5 times leverage on, that 1% is really 5%, right? If it goes up 100%, that 100% is really 500% because it's 5x leverage. So there's many different ways you can take leverage. And usually when we think about leverage in the system, we think about us retail investors. I say us because everyone listening to this most likely is a retail investor, myself included. We are usually the ones that get blamed or frowned upon for using leverage, but we can see this huge, huge unwinding now, as we spoke about already with Celsius, with Three Arrows Capital, with BlockFi, with CoinFlex. I don't know if you heard this CoinFlex one that just came out recently. So there's a lot going on in the markets with leverage, but I just wanted to really drive home that it's not just retail users. The same leverage I described and different ways to use that leverage is also being taken advantage by institutional funds. And now, okay, if I put my little $10,000 in and I leverage that up 10x, that 10,000 becomes 100,000, right? So that's a big deal to me and you and people that net worth is under 100,000. But when an institution puts in 500 million and they lever that up, you know what I mean? That's a lot different. Now we're getting up to $1 trillion worth of leverage, or $1 billion worth of leverage. And I'm not saying, I don't know the numbers exactly, but I'm just trying to drive home again the point of when these big institutions start taking out that leverage, it hits a little different than when me and you take out that leverage or make moves with that leverage. So to Winston's point, you know, leverage is being taken out all throughout the system. And this is actually this unwinding of leverage and these defaults happening from these institutions, in my opinion, can be viewed as a good thing to wash out the crypto system. When you have these bear markets, what it does is it rinses out all the fake and pretender people. And the only ones that remain are the ones that are heavily convicted. And then what happens is everyone gets rinsed out. The only people that are remaining are that's usually the bottom of the market, right? Because no one's buying. Everyone just got rinsed out. And then once they're all rinsed out, we can continue to start going back up. So I would say the fact that that is happening now, it can be slightly viewed as a positive in the grand scheme of things, because we can, the sooner all of that gets unwinded, the sooner we can get back to new all-time highs.
Yeah, man, beautifully stated. You know, one thing that I want to say about that is, man, you're absolutely right. So what Justin is talking about, the technical term, and hopefully I don't tear his word up, but rehypothecation, is what banks have been doing forever. And so there's nothing necessarily bad about this, because when you put a dollar in the bank is taking 9 of those dollars and they're lending that money out. And that's how they pay you that 0.01% high yield interest rate. You know, there's a reason that they're able to give you back a return, because they're taking that money and investing. And then they're taking those loans that they made on that $1, and then they're packaging that up and then selling it to a hedge fund. And then that hedge fund is taking it to the pension. And then, this is what investing is. So there's nothing wrong with this. What happens many times is that, you know, there's blind bets, you know, and there's a lot of faith in things where there's no substance. And, you know, Justin was talking about like the market being rinsed down. We were just talking about like having that feeler indicator. So the market got real loud, like these personalities that came out in crypto. You know, I think some of them were trying to emulate either like a Tesla type, like an Elon Musk, but Elon is super smart and super connected and has built a whole lot of stuff. So, you know, he kind of has the right to almost be a jerk in the space, because he's just like, okay, you know, I mean, look, I can be Mayweather out here. Like, yeah, I talk the noise, but I can back it up, you know, and then some. So I think a lot of people were trying to emulate. I guess they felt like they had to be these personalities. And there's one, I won't say the name in particular, but, you know, he's always talking about his Pateks and his Millies that he's watching. He's going on these
all up in the videos. All up on it.
So if you're in crypto, you already know who I'm talking about right now. And you know, is it the next Celsius or Terra? We don't know. We don't know. Time will tell. Yeah. Yeah, that might be. Yeah, there you go. But, you know, if you know, you know. So, like, a lot of these, you know, Celsius, for example, Alex was real loud a few weeks ago, you know, and it's one of those things we were just talking about, like, okay, are you becoming the exit? I'm not saying that this is necessarily what happened with Celsius, but Alex was getting really loud, and that should have been my warning sign to say, dude, withdraw today from Celsius, because, you know, he was backed up in the corner. He's got just really loud. And just like 3 days before they halted all withdrawals, he was just saying, you know, name me one time where we ever halted any withdrawals. Like, it's never happened, this and that. I should have that day. So when it gets really loud, get on defense, sell. You know, that's usually the time to sell. But money is debt. And that's maybe we can just do an episode just about that, you know, about money and currency, because crypto gets blamed so much about being funny money and this and that. But money is debt. Like, how we talked about how money gets put into the system. Money is created as a debt. And there's no money without debt. So that's one thing that, you know, you all may want to just go down a rabbit hole and just discover, like, how that works and why, like, you know, our country in particular, like, why we have access to so many things as opposed to some, you know, second and third world nations. We have access to debt. You know, we have a robust financial system, whereas, you know, we're countries that don't have the financial railings, and a lot of countries that don't have, you know, the average person doesn't have a bank account, they don't have access to debt, but we do. So, you know, we kind of have the facade of being either middle class or wealthy in some cases, but it's really just access to debt. So another tangent, yeah, and, but
Ray Dalio has a video on YouTube. It's called How the Economic Machine Works. And I would highly suggest go and check out that Ray Dalio, How the Economic Machine Works, as well as Ray Dalio, Changing World Order. Cool, you can find it right on his YouTube page. Just search that and watch both those videos. I think they're, one's like 30 minutes long, one's like 45 minutes long. But if you're having trouble grasping anything that we're talking about right now, watch those and it'll like immediately give you 2-3 steps up and you'll be like, oh, okay. You still obviously are going to need a little bit more, but you'll have a way, way better understanding. So just wanted to point those two out. Again, that was Changing World Order by Ray Dalio and How the Economic Machine Works by Ray Dalio. So check those out on YouTube if you get the chance. So let's keep going here. I know we got about like another 10 minutes before we got to hop off the call here.
Yeah.
And we were right. Just finishing up talking about the leverage and how the leverage is going through the system, not only with retail traders and investors, but also the big entities as well. So
yeah, absolutely. So bunch of leverage in the system. You know, we got I threw this up here because I put some money in this one. So we had stuff like 38,000. At one point, it was like 70,000%. You know, I'm like, man, shoot.
I mean, we all fell victim to this. I took, you know, this one was on Solana, but, you know, I was using the one on Solana. I was using the one on Avalanche. I was using the one on ETH. You know what I mean? For those that don't know, that's the Olympus DAO fork. So Olympus DAO forks. But yeah, that's exactly what I'm talking about, though. Getting caught up in the hype, right? We like, you know, I like to educate people about blockchain and crypto. And I would always tell them, hey, don't get into these extremely high risk assets unless you know what's going on. And if you don't know what's going on, then at least don't get into them with a significant amount of money that you might get upset with. So luckily I did follow those rules where I didn't put in more than I could afford to lose, but I still did put in some and I got too greedy. And instead of, you know, withdrawing as much as I could have, I only got to withdraw some of what I could have. So.
Yeah, this was, and I got the gambling chips in the background because you know, this was the far, far end of crypto. So, all right, just to put stuff in context, you know, Justin said something real important. We're talking about stuff like this and some of the things that we experimented in crypto. Now, you know, we have a degen side. Now, you know, don't get it twisted. We have a full portfolio of things, but, you know, in crypto, a lot of things have to be tested by somebody. And, you know, all of this stuff is new. You know, this is really, a lot of this is speculative and we are trying to see how this stuff works. So that's part of the education for ourselves and what we're willing to do for other people. But we would never, ever, 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 ever tell anybody to put 100%, 50%, not even 20%, you know, of your network into something crazy like this. This really was the deep end of the pool, the infinity pool that goes into the ocean, that goes into the glacier. Like, this was the far, far end of it. But, you know, this was another sign like, man, yeah, we are really at the tippy top here. Like, we are at the ledge. The
engine's right, running hot.
Yeah, yes,
indeed.
Engine
was running hot.
It was too hot. But it's a house of cards, and it fell. And that's one of the cards in the house, one of the bubbles that popped was this Terra Luna. Now, you know, the jury isn't out yet on Doquan and Terra Luna, but the more that's coming out, like, the dirtier it's getting. So I don't really know, you know, I don't want to pass judgment all the way. I did lose some money in Terra Luna. It was a couple of $100s. So I'm not crying, but I mean, it's still too. I mean, you know, I don't buy Jordans on a regular basis, but, you know, dang, I could have had me a pair of J's, you know. But
I lost some money with that, Mom.
Yeah, some people. This hurt especially bad because of the stable coin that was tied to this, and, you know, myself included. You know, I use stable coins as a part of my portfolio because it's supposed to be stable, but this algorithmic stablecoin, and none of them have worked. You know, it's still some out that we're trying to see if Frax is going to work. USDD is Luna part two, but it looks like they're trying to switch it up. But none of them work. You know, the one that Doquan tried before didn't work. And then this one popped. But this one popping was different because we talking, I don't know, the market cap was like, what, 60 billion? 40 billion, something like that.
It was like 60, 70 billion for Luna. But like you were saying, the main issue was the problem with the stable coin for Luna, because obviously, like you said, it's supposed to be stable. But then you had a lot of institutions that were using the Anchor protocol. So, you know, I go over DeFi applications, dApps, and I show people how to use them, like Invictus that Winston just had up, or like Anchor protocol, which is what led to Terra Luna's collapse. And it's unfortunate because I'm a big believer in crypto, and I try to get people out there and try new things and use these different protocols because it can be very advantageous for people. But, you know, then you see situations like this happen where the whole protocol collapses, it causes contagion, and then throughout the entire market, you see just several forced sellers. So it's pretty unfortunate that, you know, that's still going down that way.
Yeah, man. Yep. And that brings us to where we are. So just basically a domino effect on that. So that was my last slide there, but that basically puts us to today.
That's the update. So that's basically where we were. So to do a quick 30-second recap for everybody, you know, this all started. How did crypto start? Crypto started because of the 2007 financial crisis, the housing crisis, the collapse. That's when Satoshi Nakamoto created Bitcoin because of all the financial irresponsibility that happened with the banks. You may have heard of the Lehman Brothers. And if you don't know about the Lehman Brothers collapse, you should really Google that or watch the movie The Big Short. So also a good kind of summary of what happened there. But so 2007, the housing crisis, financial collapse, 2008, Bitcoin. 2007, financial collapse, 2007, quantitative easing introduced into the system, 2008, Bitcoin gets introduced by Satoshi Nakamoto. Fast forward about 10 years, and so from 2007 to 2017, quantitative easing continues. Remember Winston's chart, it was just only up and to the right for all of the entire stock market during that time. So we had that huge run up, and then that bubble all the way up until 2007 continued to go quantitative easing continued, remember, that's pumping more and more money into the system, creating a bigger and bigger bubble. That bubble got slightly tested. It got poked by COVID in 2017, caused a pretty severe crash, but the recovery from that crash was so instant that the real ramifications from that bubble popping didn't fully take place. So that led us all the way up until this year, where now we have inflation running extremely out of control. We have a lot of these bigger companies scaling back on their amount of hiring or just the amount of activity they're doing in their different businesses. We have crypto that hit an all-time high, but obviously now it's down over 70-80%. Most tokens down over 90%. So all those things that we spoke about today combined got us to where we are now. And we kind of kept it broad at the beginning, and then we got more narrowed as we got up to till now, the 2022. As far as crypto goes, like I said, a lot of that unwinding of leverage, and as Winston pointed out as well, came from Luna's collapsing, which was UST collapsing, which was Anchor Protocol collapsing, which led to retail capitulating, meaning forced selling, which led to institutions forced selling. And now we're all looking at portfolios like, bruh, it was all good just a week ago. So take a little breath there. Winston, take a bow, man. I appreciate that.
Oh, like, man, thank you.
You really broke it down very well for us. So hopefully everyone was able to kind of catch up and keep up there.
Yeah, man, all this stuff, it all matters. And, hopefully people take a look at the broader spectrum and then focus in on crypto and see how it all relates, because at the end of the day, a lot of us came here to invest. Some of us stuck around once we saw the tech. But, if you are here to invest, just keep in mind what your goals are. A lot of us came and we're like, if I can get this much, I'm gonna buy a house. I'm gonna do this for my kids. But a lot of time we kind of get caught up in the hype, and how fast it moves. This is like futures. This is like Forex. I mean, this market can move fast, both in the up direction and down, as you can see. But if this is the first time that you're here, this is not my first time here in the bear market. Think about housing. For example, there was a time where there are some clips that I curated, and hopefully I can put that together on the show. But there was a time where, like, housing has never ever been this bad, and it's never going to come back. This was like 2009. I was working in banking at the time. And I mean, there's foreclosures everywhere. You could just, when we bought our first house, we had a list of foreclosures. We just went foreclosure shopping, like just one after another, with basements, everything you wanted. And then you could offer under and, say, I need 60 days for, I mean, it was just, so if you bought a house at the top, it was a buyer's market. So you bought a house in 07 and then 2009, you're looking crazy. You're underwater. This is where we are, and this is any asset. It doesn't matter what it is, gold. It doesn't matter what it is. This is what assets do. So, hopefully you've listened to a lot of things that Justin and I have mentioned over time, and, you have your portfolio that's where you need to be as far as your risk tolerance is concerned. Hopefully you're invested in good projects. We do talk about DGEN stuff sometimes, but, don't get caught up just in that. I mean, there's a lot of great projects out here, like Solana, for example. Even though it's being poked at right now, Solana's doing some big things, in my opinion. I mean,
Solana has some big things coming, and it's still in beta. It's a blockchain that's still in beta. Some other good ones I like, we got Matic, Layer 2 solution, Optimism, Arbitrum. Chainlink still a great protocol. Cardano, I'm still a believer in Cardano. Think what you want about it, I'm still a believer in it. And then obviously Bitcoin. So those are the ones I'm kind of focusing on. I'm a little bit more stable. I have some other DGEN plays in my back pocket. Join the Discord if you want to talk about those. Obviously it's not financial advice, but might give you a better understanding of what's going on in the market. All right, Winston, we got a few seconds here. Any closing remarks before we close this out?
Yeah. I touched on it a little bit before, but just stay focused on what you're here for. Don't get caught up in the hype. And, a down market is not the end of the world. So, if you had too much in crypto and you're down bad right now, like it's all good. And it's on paper. if your portfolio was up in the six figures, it was on paper. Like, you wouldn't use it. If it's down, you know, in the single digits, it's on paper. Like, it's all good. You know, it's investing. That's what comes with it. So, you know, keep your head up. It's all good. We got some rough waters to chop ahead, but just keep your head up. It's like, it's really all good. Life is more important than all of this other stuff.
It really is. It really is. So, with that said, remember, get outside, go touch some grass. It's not all about the charts. It's not all about the assets you're investing in. Keep a steady mindset and develop a plan. Once you have your plan, execute. Winston, my good brother, we'll be back for a part three. This was part two. Appreciate y'all checking in with me. Like I said, like, share, subscribe. I would appreciate it. Hashtag don't forget to pay. And until next time, my brother.
Peace.